Sure, there's an expanded one for this.
Phoenix.
Thank you.
Okay. Back and down to Tucson.
Good evening. Welcome to the regular business meeting of the Cape Elizabeth School Board on Tuesday, April 12th, 2016. If you would please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Before we take up our agenda for tonight's meeting, I would like to acknowledge the tragedy that has befallen our community this week. This loss has deeply affected our families, students, and staff. We extend our deepest sympathies to Cole's family and friends. Please join me in a moment of silence in remembrance of Cole Amarello. Thank you. I would also like to thank administration, teachers, and staff for your sensitivity in caring for our students and helping them navigate this loss as you yourself try to do the same. Thank you. And now to our agenda, item one, are there any adjustments to the agenda? I will say that I'm going to add a brief superintendent search update, which is not part of our communications, but needs to be. Any other adjustments? Moving on to item two. May I have a motion, please?
I move that we approve the school board minutes as listed under item 2A through 2G in the agenda.
Second?
I second.
All those in favor? Thank you. Item three, comments by student representative.
All right, so in light of recent events, it's been pretty difficult at the high school. We had two deaths within a week of each other. My fellow classmate, Mrs. Wilson, she passed away as well as Cole Brown. Morale has been pretty low this week, I'm going to say, unfortunately. Today it was slightly higher. The schools have done a good job of providing outlets for students who are having trouble, such as the Achievement Center or the library, where students can go and talk to people and just kind of cope with what has been going on recently. And Cole really, I think, affected a large portion of the student body. I know personally, although I did not know him that well, his contagious smile he had every day and his personality and just kind of the joy that he brought to CEHS is definitely going to be missed. And moving on to a lighter note, we've had Model UN went to Boston College Model UN, and people won individual awards there as well. Recently, I believe it back in March 13th, the chess team won another state championship. And we also had the unified basketball team, which they played their game against the staff at the end of the Spirit Week and actually won with a buzzer beater towards the end, and everyone rushed out on the floor, which was a really great moment, I wanted to say, for the school. And then we had Pi Day, where one of my classmates recited Pi up to, I believe, 238 numbers, which is quite crazy. I don't think I have that memory. And today we had SATs. Again, the school gave options whether for students who wanted to take it and whatnot. And break is definitely going to be well needed for all the students in light of recent events. And there's been some sickness floating around, so it would be nice for everyone to kind of go on break and relax and hopefully be rejuvenated coming back, as AP exams are coming up soon, so students will probably be hopefully, I mean, I know teachers hope that students will be studying for AP exams over break and whatnot and preparing for those. So that's what's been going on. Thank you.
Thank you. Item number four, are there any comments from the public on agenda items? Seeing none. Moving on to communications. We have strategic plan updates.
And I think we're starting with the presentation on the teacher and administrator evaluation system, and Marguerite Lawler-Roner and Beth Milroy are chairing that steering committee, and I think they're going to start, and Erin Filio is here as well, and Michael Efron, and Kelly Hassan and Jeff Shedd are also members of that committee, and Susan Dana.
Hi, I'm Marguerite, and I guess I'm up here alone right now. I believe you've got all the documents that we've worked with. You should have the principal and the teacher evaluation packet. I forwarded the report that you have the report also. I forwarded it to Andrea Fuller. We have 15 minutes, and we want to give you a brief update of where we are, where we're going, what we're doing, and then answer any concerning questions you may have. So we have just completed the first pilot, and we understand that we are going into another pilot year, which is good news for all of us. Because as you know, starting anything out, you don't know what you're getting into until at least you've run through it a couple of times. We have adopted the Marshall Plan, and Erin Filio is going to speak about it. Where teacher evaluation came out of was the state law, LD 1858, the Act to Ensure Effective Teaching and School Leadership. We had a plan already in place that you are familiar with, which was time for an overhaul. We adopted the Marshall Plan after much research through the Teacher Evaluation Committee because we felt it fit philosophically with our district and that it treated the process more holistically. So I'm going to get Erin up here now to tell you about the Marshall Plan.
Thank you.
It's not the Marshall Plan.
Yes, it's not.
I was wondering about that. Thank you, Meredith.
But he is a history teacher, so he could certainly walk through the Marshall Plan.
I would defer to Mark Ash if you wanted to talk about the Marshall Plan. So as Marguerite said, the Marshall Plan, the state provides a couple of choices, Marzano, Danielson, and Kim Marshall. And the Kim Marshall Plan, what we like about it is what they call the mini observations. And so, you know, essentially administrators are encouraged to come into the classroom more frequently as opposed to the old model, which was, you know, one or two visits into the classroom announced. We called it the old dog and pony show because teachers would know what's coming and get prepared. And do things that they may not typically do on a regular day. So this is unannounced. Administrators come in 10 or 15 minutes. There's a process afterwards where a conversation takes place. So the idea is that we create an atmosphere where administrators are around more. They're in and out of classrooms more. They're having real, authentic, genuine, meaningful conversations with teachers about what they see, what they observe in real time. What will follow will be a very succinct summary of the visit, and that all goes into the evaluation. There's a mid-cycle conference where you sit down and you go over your goals, which are done prior to. And then at the end, you have a summative conference where you score your rubric. There's six or seven components to the rubric, and you and the evaluator sit down and you cross-reference and you have conversations moving forward, and it's a four-point scale. We've tried it. We've had Kim Marshall come in, speak to us. He's a great presenter. really put a lot of research, and it's unique. It's unique, and so we found it to be a very successful so far in what we've done. And I'll have, is the good doctor coming up, or is Steph coming up?
Hi, I'm Beth Milroy, a teacher at the high school. So I'm going to just give some highlights about where we currently are. The steering committee has been charged with overseeing this pilot that just was completed, and will be in place also to oversee the pilot through next year. What's wonderful about the committee is that it includes educators from all three schools, as well as representative from CEA, administrators, all mandated by the state. We have completed a very brief 5-month pilot, and we will begin piloting our new pilot for next year, starting with names of participants as of May the 1st. And those names will be given to us from the administrators at each of the buildings. The data that we collect through next year's pilot will help us modify and refine the evaluation plan moving forward, in addition to the information and feedback that we've received from teachers who are currently in the pilot program, has helped the committee also take a look at the pilot and begin conversations about modifying it. And then the last is, as you know, our district can make changes to the plan at any time with school board and Department of Education approval. Dr. Ephraim.
Hi, you all. So I'm going to tell you the things that have gone particularly well in this pilot year. When Kim Marshall came last summer and did a whole day workshop with administrators and a couple of teachers, I know at the beginning of that workshop I was dreading being there for 6 hours, but Mr. Marshall is an excellent presenter. The time flew by. He's really very good. And then he came and did in service with each of the building faculties at the beginning of the year. And those went very well. Everybody just loves to hear how they're going to get evaluated. It's a very popular thing. We then had a session where we sat down with faculty and helped brainstorm with everybody who came in writing professional goals for themselves and goals for the students. And I think that was really valuable for the folks who came. As Aaron said, I think that what's been really the best part of this whole pilot has been seeing the evaluators coming in a lot, followed very quickly with feedback sessions and discussions over the observation. I think that's been really well received in all three buildings. One reason I can say that is pat the steering committee on the back. We have tried very hard every step of the way to continually get feedback from teachers as to how they're receiving this, how it's going. And so at every point, we've been getting feedback from teachers that gets shared at the steering committee meetings. It gets shared back with the principals. And so they're getting feedback as to how it's going. That's been the most popular part of the program. Having the teacher, having the administration come in to the classroom regularly and then sit down and talk to us about what they saw. And that's it. That's my part of this discussion.
Thank you.
So as I said earlier, we finished the first pilot April 1st. We understand that we need to streamline the process without compromising the integrity of the plan so that it's attainable, because after May 1st, one-third of each building will be in the new pilot, and we're talking about teachers. So in order to do that, we've got to find a way to make it a priority in our district, assessment literacy, which we've already begun. Fitting it in so it's not something people are going to avoid, and I'm talking about evaluator and evaluatee. We've got to work together, so we've got to fit it in, and it's got to be manageable, and it's got to be realistic. So that's what we need to work on. We need to go back into the rubrics. We need to go back into the forms and see, can we improve them? Do we need to? At this point, we know the forms need work, and we believe that after piloting next year, we'll know where we stand with the rubrics. Right now, everything still feels very new, and the Teacher Evaluation Committee voted to keep them in, and where we are right now, we modified the pilot using one rubric for evaluation because it was just too much. The other piece is, with the completed SMART goals that the teachers fill out and they follow through, this is a part of their evaluation. When you come to the summative, what goes into your file is a form that, you know, checks off, yes, you're right on track. It will be on the teacher's onus to keep the evidence of everything else, especially if they choose to say, no, I don't agree with this, you know, evaluation. So it would be the evidence of growth. It would be copies of everything you've done with your evaluator you can keep. We do have an appeals process set up. We haven't used it because we haven't had the need to, but we will need to look at that in the future. We need to look at, well, we're going to find out, hopefully, what, a, well, maybe not hopefully, we want to find out what a directed plan and monitored plan feels like, because we haven't had that in this pilot. We need to, things we're looking at, joining the Southern Maine Marshall Consortium. We don't know what that means, but we want to look at it. And we want to, there was some talk about exploring wwteval.com, an efficient method to document many observations and briefs. That would make sense. Provide teachers with the organizational tools so they understand what they're getting into as they get into it. We had already done this in the first pilot, but we'll refine it further with the new pilot coming up. We need to develop rubrics with the nurses, librarians, technology specialists, psychologists, guidance, social work, speech, PT, and OT with them to get them going for evaluation. We need to develop the structures of support for the monitored and directed plans. If we get people on them, we need to have the support in place rather than, you know, what does it look like? How do we intervene? How do we get the support as needed? We need to support a mentor program through training and funding for the directed and the modified plans. Simplify the goal process, maybe one for administrators as opposed to two. Ongoing funding for the committee itself. Funding for summer work for the recommendations listed above. Probationary teachers are not a part of this. They are following the old plan, and that will stay in place. In conclusion, there are elements of the plans that are not complete and will be need to be finished by the end of next year's pilot. We'll have a better idea where we are. There are a lot of good things going on. We need to send out surveys and analyze with this pilot, you know, what worked, what didn't. We've already started doing that, but we really need to process it and look at it so we can improve upon and make something that's pragmatic, realistic, and doable, and a win-win for both parties, evaluator and the evaluated. The teacher performance and evaluation plans in progress. We anticipate there will be changes, and you know, we're all going to be in it together. The principal plan, I guess, I don't know about that one, but we're working on those forms. We, Meredith, myself, and a few others were submitting this to the state, and if you have any questions, we'll gladly answer them.
May I just add a couple things? So in terms of the principal plan, it follows a very similar format. There's a set of rubrics for principals. It's a similar format in terms of goal setting. Forms are similar. You know, the process follows a similar, slightly altered timeline just because of sort of what the law says around principal renewal timelines versus teacher renewal timelines. But I think we have found many of the same things. All of those rubrics was a bit unwieldy. Can we prioritize somewhere within there? The paperwork itself, as we sort of worked through, okay, we have to have 12, you know, copies of this, and you've got a sign here, and did you check that box? We found that, you know, our experience with that was we weren't there yet, and simplifying that would make some sense. I think we, you know, had the same discovery that this will be better. It's been a very compressed timeline, and so we were setting goals for kind of a 5-month period to sort of see, oh, what will this look like. But realistically, as we move forward, those goals will be set on an annual basis, and in the case of continuing contract folks, those are set over a 3-year period, so you have more time to really take a look at that work and adjust and revise. But I think, you know, the same piece, a sort of goal focused, professionally focused conversation around, geez, what's going really well in your work? Where are some areas that we can agree you might need to improve? I think that's the value of this work. And again, that frequency, you know, is sort of the secret to that. And really, the winners are student learning at the end of this. It's not about, you know, teachers or administrators. It's really about, are we doing the best work that we can do for kids on a daily basis? And we're glad that the state decided to give another year for the pilot, because our experience is not dissimilar to that of other districts. There are a lot of moving parts, and we want to get it right. It's important work. It determines sort of people's professional future, but it also determines, you know, it's a measure of the work that we're doing for kids every day, and that feedback is really important.
The reason why the pilot was, we had to move backwards because we have a deadline with the state. So that's why we had the 5-month window. And the teacher evaluation document that you had has the 3 consortiums. When we go into full evaluation cycle, they will end in February because of contract renewals, budget. So we are honoring that with the new pilot, that the new pilot will end in February, so that's why we're starting in May. So that teachers that are in this pilot have the opportunity to have the orientation, know what's in front of them, and be ready to hit the ground running in the fall.
I'm so glad that there's an extension for the pilot. I think that's just gonna make the next pilot that much more smooth. But I'm also wondering if it will help in the area that we talked a lot about in the evaluation committee, which is selling the system to everybody. To like how much I'm wondering how much of the teachers who are not currently in the pilot, or even those who are aware of that this Marshall Plan in particular really encourages best practices, and it's a unified approach to, you know, making the whole school you know, want to work together to improve. And I know we said something about like the way this is presented is going to be very important, so that teachers don't feel that you know, it's going to be overwhelming or that anybody's out to get them. And I'm glad that with the pilot, an additional pilot time, that can be focused on even more so. I'm just wondering at this point what the feedback is from those who are aware of the system.
At the middle school, I can speak for that, and I did pilot. I was also, you know, being observed. The overwhelming response is they liked having evaluators in the classroom and talking about their practice. And the walkthroughs were great, the mini observations. At first, people were really kind of overwhelmed and afraid, because it's like, what does this all mean? And we didn't know. You know, we could tell them what we thought it meant, and this is the process we're following. But now that it's ended, it's been bumpy at times, but it's because there's a learning curve for everybody. And I think our best ambassadors that's spoken in the meetings are the teachers and the pilot now. You know, how you've got somebody in your room watching what you do and listening to you talk about your practice, how can that be a bad thing? And comparatively speaking, from the old model, it's a vast improvement. Mm-hmm. And I think just by that communication in the building, it changes the feel of the building, the climate in itself. You know, it keeps, because teaching's an isolating practice. You're in your room, you know, you're autonomous, you're doing your thing. You're with kids all day, you don't talk to adults that much. But having somebody in and they want to talk to us about you and what you do is kind of luxurious in a strange way. But I believe it will be successful, and it's the law, so we're going to be doing it. And a lot of time's been put into it to make sure that it's manageable.
I would say we've also heard some skepticism about, can administrators take all of this on? How are they going to manage the time? What else is coming off the plate? And we've had some conversations about that at the administrative team level. It's not, I mean, it has to be a priority, but carving out that time can be difficult as things arise in the course of a day. And, you know, we've talked that, you know, if you have, you know, a couple of observations sort of scheduled every day, it's doable. But then you have to make sure you have the follow-up conversation, and you have to then make sure you get that little paragraph done that goes along with it. And so sort of streamlining that, getting better at, okay, I'm used to writing 3-page narratives, not looking at anyone in the audience in particular, but if you're used to, you know, we're used to sort of that model where you write a 3-page narrative and now you've got to cut it down to a 1,000-character little paragraph. And so being really succinct and picking out those 2 or 3 key coaching and feedback points is an art, and it's a different skill than the one that administrators have practiced before. So those pieces are part of the learning curve for administrators, but again, in fairness, we're grappling with where are we going to find that time, how do I sort of move other things off and make that a priority, and we may wind up with different numbers as we move forward, but I think we're still optimistic that it can be done.
Well, the one advantage we had is we've done it once, so it's got to be better this time because we all have a little behind us. So,
true. Barbara? Question and a comment, Marguerite. One is the one real sort of bone of contention with this whole legislation was the student learning model. And I'm wondering how that's played out in the pilot, where you had to set goals for student learning and then track that and report that out as part of this whole thing. And I'm also wondering what the percent impact was selected for that.
I can speak for Allied Arts. I can speak for myself because it looks different in every content area. Mm-hmm. The state didn't have a test that we could align with.
Right.
You know, and what we talked about in the steering committee is student growth is you use your classroom, where you expect to see growth as a teacher. And what I did is I used 3 different fifth grades because I teach them each throughout the year. And I expected 100% growth. And it was because I knew from past experience I'd get it, and it was how I attained it which was different. With, I think Meredith could speak better with the academics, the challenges there because the state is vague. And I don't think they're sure what they want.
I think, you know, there's a possibility that with ESSA, that the legislation may change around the connection to the state assessment. At the moment, that's still in place, but because last year's assessment got scrapped, that was gonna be the baseline that we built on this year, and that got scrapped, and now we have a new assessment. Honestly, I'm not sure how we could have done that in the pilot window. So, you know, we've designed, I think, a student learning and growth rubric that really lets us weigh, are we making good instructional decisions? Are we making appropriate adjustments around student learning and adding additional resources or increasing the level of challenge as we see our students work through the goals that we've set? And I think we feel like that's the pragmatic and right way to look at student learning and growth. Are we as faculty members adjusting appropriately and responding appropriately as we do that work. But I think over the next year, we'll see what happens legislatively with that particular piece in terms of a tie to standardized assessment, because right now it's still ambiguous.
And you're at 15%?
It's, again, we've developed a rubric that doesn't give a percentile, but it shows that as you sort of look at that grid, it weights it in enough of a format that we think it's going to satisfy that test. We would be hard pressed to put a numerical value on it, but.
Yeah. No, but you know what I found with just going through it myself, it did have me observe, and re-examining my teaching practice and just developmentally where the students were and how they learned. And it had nothing to do with grading, it was just how to approach it differently. Right. And that's good practice.
Well, the rubric's brilliant. You know, I'm really glad to see you all chose that of all of them. So my comment then is, in terms of the Southern Maine Marshall Consortium, I didn't know that had grouped, but there may be, because I know a lot of districts have been at this a little longer,
right.
There may be some real pragmatic answers out there about how to manage the feedback loops, for example. That's a huge issue for principals, and I think it would be great for us to learn from them too, so that this can really be as robust as possible.
Yeah, we agree with you.
Yeah, I would encourage you to feel that out.
Joe?
On a slightly different direction, I'm wondering, on the last page, one of the bullets is ongoing funding for the Cape Elizabeth School Department Performance Evaluation and Professional Growth Model. I'm wondering if you could speak a little bit more about how the funding, what exactly would that support?
What that means is it's the steering committee is a stipend position for teachers. It's after school hours and the work you do. And I guess that would be just keep it in the budget, because guess what? We've got a lot of work to do. And that's what that addresses. What we have ahead of us, not only the pilot, but we've got to get, you know, the nurses and everybody else, we've got to get those rubrics developed and get that moving forward too. So it's just not to lose sight of the fact that it's going to be work and it will need to be supported.
And there will be ongoing training needs,
yes.
Piece of it as well. You know, you can't sort of train once and then you're done. There will be an ongoing need to sort of refresh that and polish that and make adjustments to that. So. And not that there isn't always that attached to evaluation, but I think in the short term, we know that will be a heavier impact.
A priority, sure. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome.
John?
So just to step back for a second, we're a relatively new board member. This is sort of in process when I joined. And to understand, this is now a state-mandated process that we're going through in a pilot. And it looks like an effort to focus on professional development and student learning. And what I guess I would say is I think we, as you sort of pointed out, we really do have an opportunity here to get our instruction and our outcomes better. And the student learning ones, some of those are always going to be a little ephemeral, but I really think that it would be worth thinking about in very simple ways for yourselves as a professional learning community, what are the metrics and the outcomes that we're looking to achieve? And that may be something simple as self-assessments. Do I think that myself and or my colleagues are actively developing professionally and using best practices? So whatever the sentences that you want to be able to say, we now do this and this is how we identify ourselves in a very brief summary way. I think that's really important because it's really hard to get people to read this whole thing.
You didn't find that fascinating?
It's not only me. But my point is, for yourselves and everybody you talk about, you want to control the conversation in the hallways. What are we doing here? We're trying to achieve this, and this is how we measure it. And it's up to you. You know, the state's not going to tell us that. I think we'll have a better one ourselves, and I think it's a real opportunity to think about the change that we want to make and how that's going to, because if you change the instruction, I think you'll see it in the student learning.
So. I think here at Cape Elizabeth, with the caliber of teachers that you do have, that is already in place with PLCs and practice. Just, you know, you do it by nature modifying, and we do have assessment literacy that's been provided and ongoing. And yeah, the art of teaching, it's ongoing. And the assessment, how do we meet the needs of students? How do we propel them to more success? You know, it makes sense.
guess what I'm saying is if we're doing something different and we're looking for an outcome, what's the outcome?
Improve professional practice. I mean, it is
And that reflects the student learning.
Yeah. And we're measuring that through two ways. One is sort of that assessment. I understand. Yeah. I know exactly where you're going. What's the speech, the elevator speech, essentially?
It needs to boil down. This is what we're trying to achieve, and here's how we measure it. And there's a lot that goes into that. This is just the tip that floats above the water.
Yep.
But right, I'm just urging to get the piece that floats above the water.
I think that's right on the school website at the high school, what you need in order to graduate. It lists that's where I tie everything in that I teach. Because I'll say every eighth grader should know this, and then I'll say what they need for the proficiency base. But yeah, I agree with you. There's got to be a real clean message.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's our introduction, but I think you're right. That may be refined as we move forward because we may hone these rubrics. We may refine the goal setting process as this moves forward. But I think we tried to lay that out in our introduction, which was really sort of what is this committee trying to do? What is the goal of this work? So but
it appears to me this sort of has two audiences, one of which is the state, and they have their things that they need, and that's fine. But I'm saying the second audience is us and the community, and we need the introduction and the metrics piece for us, and I feel like that's currently missing.
Any other questions?
Maybe it's more observation or a request. As a district, I know a strategic plan, this might be one line item that says, you know, implement and develop a new teacher evaluation system. But at the time, the missing ingredient was, you know, how much time would that take? You know, if each administrator has to meet at least 5 times per year, and for probationary, 10 times, you know, that was information at the time the strategic plan was developed that we didn't know. So one request, and I think reflecting back on feedback from staff, administrators, or as a board member, community member, where does this rank over the next 2 years, a year, in terms of all the goals and priorities? So I think it's more of a question maybe going into next year. Okay, how does this rank among the other things that we're being asked to do as parents, staff, and administrators, so everyone knows, is this kind of important? Is this super important? Does it have to be done? So I think it would be helpful, and I don't have the answer or the expertise, but you know, going into next year, you know, we're aligned. Okay, what are the 3 big things that we're all gonna focus on? So when time allocation has to be made, administrators know this is a priority. Maybe that other area that we would like to do, you know, it's not a priority. So I think that would be very helpful for the community, for teachers, for administrators, just so we're all rowing in the same direction. Because I think this could either turn out to be a fantastic model, you know, for achieving so many goals and sustaining the excellence of schools. Professional practice, we have fantastic staff, of course, they want to get feedback on how they're doing professionally. For student learning, that's why we're all here. So I think if it's done properly, it could be a great model for, you know, collaboration and implementing achieving a lot of the outcomes we want. So that's a long-winded speech of getting it down to what are the 3 priorities for the district going forward, and are we all on the same page? So thank you for your work and everyone's work on this. I think it was very helpful.
Good. I'm going to end. So I thank you for taking your time to come and present to us. Thank you to everyone who's doing this careful, thoughtful work. It's great to hear about that constant feedback loop. I think that's really important. And it sounds kind of exciting to me. And I hope it feels that way, at least to some people.
So please don't take my comments in any way. I'm very appreciative of the work that you're doing, and I'm very supportive of it. I just want to, I'm hoping to improve.
We're fine.
Yeah.
No, it's good to get feedback. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And so next up, we have a middle school mathematics update.
We have been looking at middle school mathematics over the last couple of years, and as we have looked at the leveling and the implications for where classes need to go, we've been looking at our alignment to standards, our discussion of teaching practices and pedagogy, and decided that it would behoove us to bring in an expert to work with some of our teachers to look at unpacking the standards. What are some of the non-negotiable pieces that need to be taught? What does that look like? What are the learning progressions? And then build our courses from there. And in the process of those discussions, obviously that can't happen in a vacuum at the middle grades. It has implications for K through 4, 5, 8, and up into the high school. So we've been working with Professor Mahesh Sharma, who is the founder of the Center for Teaching and Learning of Mathematics in Framingham, Massachusetts. And he has worked with our grades 4 through 12 teachers for one day so far, looking at some of those non-negotiables. What is it in the standards that are the have-tos at each grade level? What does that look like? Looking at K2 primarily being additive reasoning, addition, subtraction, getting that as a really strong foundation. Grades 3, 4, multiplicative, multiplication, division. 5, 6, moving into proportional reasoning, fractions, ratios, decimals. What does that look like? Then moving into algebraic thinking, 7th and 8th grade, and up into the upper mathematics. Now, that doesn't mean that algebra can't happen interwoven through all of those, because algebraic skills need to start at the early grades for that to be an ongoing, understood process. But helping teachers to understand those progressions, what needs to be mastered, and what the pedagogy is behind that. He's going to be meeting with our grades 4 through 12 teachers again tomorrow to be working more on that, and we have a second date scheduled on the 26th of April for our grades K through 6, because we couldn't seem to get everybody in the same spot at once. So we're doing some overlaps to make sure that we have the transition grades covered. We'll also be having a parent night tomorrow night to kind of talk about the changes that are happening in leveling and in the focus of our instruction, primarily focusing on grades 4 through 11, so they'll be going into grades 5 through 12. And we'll have Professor Sharma there to address particularly the importance of algebraic concepts in that whole mix and why that's such a foundational piece. Do you want to add anything to? Yeah, okay.
Part of what we've been focusing on with Dr. Sharma is not only talking about alignment to the Common Core, but this idea of pedagogy that Ruth Allen was talking about, and so that we can't have discussions about mastery of standards without also looking at our teaching pedagogy. So he's talked with us about what we're calling a 25-50-25 pedagogical model, where he's recommending that we spend 25% of our class time on whole class tool building, so that we lead to 50% of our class time whole class instruction, again exploring that main concept, and then taking 25% of class time on differentiated practice that includes small group and individual instruction as needed, and that any required intervention or remediation is something that happens in addition to that classroom practice, and it's not in place of it. So as we've been looking at mastery, we're hearing a lot about how mastery is made up of components of having an understanding and a fluency and an applicability. And so we've been looking a lot at that in terms of how is it we are teaching for a true understanding of mathematics. And a powerful takeaway that I've had from listening to Professor Sharma is he talks about how every math concept has three components. It has a linguistic component, a conceptual component, and a procedural component. So as we're looking at really deepening understanding of mathematics, we have to make sure we're teaching and assessing for the linguistic, the conceptual, and the procedural. So those have been some takeaways I think we'll explore some more of that tomorrow during our PD session. And then tomorrow, as we talk with parents, you know, the middle school mathematics teachers have been looking at recommendations that Dr. Sharma has made. And, you know, I'm pleased that we seem to have a consensus about the kinds of courses we are feeling we need to offer, the alignment that we need to be doing in terms of the Common Core. And as we're making plans for next year and what we're hoping to talk with parents about, we have all of our mathematics teachers at the middle school are on board and have consensus about where we think together we need to go next. So,
can I just add one thing about Dr. Sharma? So part of the reason that we chose him to work with is because we've had a number of teachers who have attended his trainings offered over summers over a number of years, and that had started before I came here, but he offers kind of week-long institutes in the summer, and he's offered a lot of one-day trainings around the area, and staff who have attended have, and he has been here in the past as well, but staff who have attended his trainings have felt strongly that his message has resonated with them, and that includes Ponco's math lab coordinator and you know, department chair folks from the high school and several staff from the middle school as well. So that I think was really helpful to us as we sort of move forward, like, here's a person that we have some agreement around different buildings who can be a resource to us, who brings clearly background knowledge and expertise in this field. And so far I think that work is going well.
Maybe just you know, what I'm trying to understand is what is the deliverable? What's the goal? We have you know, Dr. Sharma helping us look at different options. You know, for those that aren't as well educated in the educational jargons, you know, rubrics and leveling, you know, as a parent or a teacher or a citizen, you know, there's a consultant coming in to help do what? And is it a information gathering? And then there's another group of teachers, administrators that are going to deliver. Is it a new curriculum? Is it a sequencing of class? I think it would help just share with what's the goal.
I would say initially we looked at having him come in and work with teachers to really look at what are the non-negotiables, what is the absolute must master at each grade level, so that forms the foundation of how do we build our classes from there. If this is what each student needs to take away, then how do we look at the progression? How do we look at how we deliver that instruction to make sure each student is there? And what do we look at for leveling to ensure that each student has a pathway to get where he or she needs to go in a reasonable amount of time? So that was kind of the, let's look at what needs to be done, how it needs to be done, and that kind of gave us a framework for what the courses may look like. And we're still looking, middle school is firming up, high school implications are still a year or two out as we're looking at changes that may come down the road, but we're certainly not saying, and here's the entire roadmap now, because it's a process. But that's really where it started, was what does each student really need to understand? What does that look like? And then how do we deliver that to make sure that each student gets that in a way that is meaningful and transferable?
And my last piece is, I know there's been changes in math at the middle school, and the board had some feedback on, you know, different opportunities to make it a more inclusive process. So, you know, maybe you could just share what's the structure. You know, there's, you get this information, some teachers may like, you know, the direction or the feedback from Dr. Sharma, but what's the decision-making process, both at the middle school and maybe at the high school? If there's a change in sequencing, how do we provide opportunities so everyone had a, you know, a voice in the decision process? And that doesn't mean it has to be a consensus decision. It can be, we want your input, but here's how the decision's going to be made. But I think it would be helpful for us to understand that.
The mechanism at the middle school would be the common planning time meetings, so often we strive for a representation of the variety of grade levels and courses that teachers teach, who can come, can hear, and work with Dr. Sharma, go back, report to their teams. Every Monday at the middle school, each grade level of mathematics teachers meet for common planning time, and we'll go around and we'll follow up and have conversation about, here's what we heard, how is your curriculum alignment going with the Common Core? What are you thinking in terms of what your students are demonstrating in terms of readiness for next year? How do we know? What data are we using? What criteria? So we're continually having those conversations about making sure we're clear, what is it we want the students to know and be able to do? How are we assessing how well they can do that? And are we making plans to ensure that they have mastery to go on to what's next, whether it be the next year or several years or college and career readiness? So that mechanism is a weekly ongoing dialogue and conversation at the middle school. Principal Hassan, Principal Shedd, and I will get together and talk as a DLT with Ruth Allen. We'll talk about ongoing developments, questions, concerns, and we're working very hard to stay aligned. To answer your previous question, what is the deliverable we're hoping for? It would be a clearly articulated, coherent K-12 math curriculum in the instance of math. I'd say is what we're working towards.
Great, thank you.
And I would just say there are standards that students have to meet in order to graduate. I mean, we're in a proficiency-based system for our students entering school. As we move forward, they're going to have to meet those standards. And so it's incumbent upon us to build a system that gets them there. And that's what this work is about.
Thank you.
John?
So let me see if I got this right so I understand it. So it sounds like what you've done is taken the standards for each grade level in mathematics and made them uniform across all instruction, and then you've taken also the advice of a consultant to sequence the concepts in an appropriate, most advantageous way. And does this result in some sort of document or system that is continually updated so that it sounds like things were somewhat out of alignment and sort of somewhat unsequenced so that we can maintain this on a going forward basis, and what does that look like?
It's a work in progress, and I will say curriculum is one of those things that is never done. It should always be in process, but we are looking at moving from a practice that has been, frankly, somewhat textbook driven. We have a book, and here's what we're doing, as opposed to we now have standards. We've always had standards, but here is a sequence, and we have textbook series that are great resources, and they may or may not follow the same sequence that we're looking at pedagogically is the direction we want to go. So how do we take what we have, use that to our best advantage and to what students need, and still be able to deliver that? So our curriculum is moving from here's the book to here's the sequence, here are the learning targets, here's what needs to be done, and here's what you can use to do that.
There's so lovely music in the background.
Very nice.
And the term of art for that, John, is curriculum mapping, and that's a practice that educators routinely engage in, and theoretically those maps are captured digitally.
Yes.
But we don't have a tool in place that is set up for that specifically, so we have created templates and that process is continuing to evolve.
Eventually, that may very well be a budget request, but it's not right now.
It would seem to me that that's something every math teacher should have at their desk. So,
at this desk. At the digital desk, ultimately.
Right. On their phone.
Oh, exactly. Thank you.
Sorry for the fairy music.
Thank you. Moving on, this is the slight adjustment to your agenda, which is the superintendent search update. It was just a month ago that I gave an update, although it feels so much longer ago. There has been a lot of work done. At our last business meeting, we appointed the advisory screening committee. That committee came together, worked very diligently, and spent hours upon hours upon hours reading applications and went forward through that process, and then brought that work to the interview committee, which went through that work and went through an interview process with candidates, and made recommendations to the board, who then went through another round of interviews with candidates, and has brought us to the announcement of two finalists, Dr. Craig King and Stephen Bailey, who will be in district on the week following April vacation. It was important to us that everybody have their, we wanted to be respectful. Going into vacation, people kind of are, you know, the students are getting a little wild, and teacher, we're all ready to move on. So we wanted to be respectful of everybody, have that in-district day for each candidate after vacation. And it's fair warning to administrators, everybody comb their hair and shine your shoes. Be ready. we're looking at Monday, April 25th for Stephen Bailey, and Wednesday, April 27th for Craig King, and more information coming out to everybody soon, but that's where we are in the process. And as of today, at this moment, we are still on track to hire in May, and this hopefully is wood, knock on wood. And I would like to just take this opportunity to thank everybody. We've had lots of different stakeholders, and the board has put in an inordinate amount of work. And I would like to first thank everybody for all that work. And also thank everybody for the way that they did that work, which was with honesty and respect and diligence. And it's been a wonderful process to be a part of. And so I thank everybody.
Thank you for leading us in the charge, Elizabeth. You've done a great job.
Thank you.
Are you moving on? Are we moving on to B now C? Okay. So I want to just start by thanking people also for the support provided this in recent days, to include parental support with food and all sorts of snacks provided at the high school, and lots of emotional support. And you know, we had support. Yes, we've had an outpouring of support from neighboring school districts, just, you know, everyone sort of willing to do what they can to support this community in a tough time, and we appreciate that very much, and know that, you know, when it is another community facing those challenges, we hope we can provide the same level of support. So thank you for that. I also want to just thank the TIPS program in Portland, Trauma Intervention Program, who provided some support at the town library yesterday for alumni as well. And we appreciate sort of their gracious 11th hour willingness to come and lend a hand. So a lot of retirees who came back to provide some support over the last couple days as well. And again, it just one of the hallmarks of what a great community this is to work in. So thanks for all of that. I want to acknowledge one resignation from the middle school, and Elizabeth Johnston, who is a teacher at the middle school, she's been one of our interventionists, is leaving us at the end of the school year, so we wish her the best in her new pursuits. An update on emergency management, just to acknowledge publicly that we did some training last week district-wide on an internal communication system that we hope will help us in emergency situations be able to communicate quickly across schools, across our town campus as well, and that includes community services and the library, who, as folks know, are in close proximity to us, the pool. so that was helpful, and we expect that we'll be providing the board with some further information about emergency management over the next couple of months, but that was a good piece for us to be able to move forward. Jessica Clark, our incoming special ed director, will be here with us after vacation for a couple of days as well, just meeting with folks and kind of getting up to speed on the work ahead of her, so that will be helpful. I heard from our community services director, Russell Packett, today that last night the Jordan Trust approved setting aside $24,500 to support families with financial need for preschool at Cape Care. So we are
delighted with that news, and we'll be working to kind of get that word out so that if you're aware of a family in financial need or you have a financial need for a preschool student, they will be able to provide some support, again, based on those income parameters. Let's see, what am I missing? We had a lot of stuff coming up after vacation, but I think right now we're all looking forward to wrapping up Thursday. We had scheduled, in light of the evaluation pieces that we were just talking about, we were scheduled to have an assessment literacy training this Thursday afternoon. Due to recent events, we've had conversations about changing that to a wellness-based afternoon for staff. So we're coordinating some activities for that and hope to get that word out district-wide tomorrow. But we've had, again, some great community volunteers who stepped up and a lot of staff volunteers willing to offer some stress reduction and relieving activities for staff. So we look forward to it.
Thanks for the flexibility around that. I'm sure everybody appreciates that. Moving on to item six, new business. May I have a motion, please?
I move we approve the 2016-2017 school budget in the amount of $24,287,545 and the related revenue components for presentation to the town council.
I second the motion. And discussion?
I'd like to just give a brief overview of where we are. Pardon my voice, I think I'm losing it. This evening, the Finance Committee is sending forth to our regular business meeting our proposed budget for the 2016-2017 Cape Elizabeth school year. After meeting four times over the course of last month, the board has stated it is ready to propose the budget estimates in details for the following sums for the following required functions in support of our schools in accordance with MRSA, Title 28, subsection 1485, and there are 11 subsections according to the law. Regular instruction, 11 million or so. Special education, 3 million or so. Career and technical education, around 55,000. Instruction, including summer school and extracurricular instruction, around $850,000. Student and staff support, $2,540,000 or so. System administration, $745,000. School administration, $1.1 million. Transportation and buses, $3.1 million. Debt service and other commitments of $500,000. And all other expenditures, including school lunch, for $32,000. While this layout is our budget per statutory requirement, there are also a number of handouts on our website breaking out our budget numbers in more familiar ways. Let me highlight some of those breakouts. The biggest challenge this year was the reduction of $778,684 in state general aid. There was also a reduction of $7,000 for reimbursement from the state and funding to state to serve state agency clients. By using an out-of-the-ordinary supplement of $300,000 from undesignated fund balance, we were able to bring the revenue shortfall to a mere little under $500,000 in decreased revenue for our district. It is important to note that this reduces our It is important to note that this reduces our undesignated fund balance to around $419,000, leaving us with about less than 2% of our budget in that account. This is an amount the auditors prefer to see, and could hamper our ability to protect our taxpayers from future reductions in state funding, like we are currently experiencing this year. On the expenditure side, our operating expenditures increased by $464,713, or 1.97%, driven largely by staffing and benefits, with offsets from the town for shared costs for facilities, technology, and HR services. 82% of our costs are driven by salaries and benefits. That includes collective bargaining agreements for base salary increases of 2.25% to 2.5% between all of our collective bargaining agreements. Our schools are among the best in the state, and this is due largely to the investment we make in the people who make our schools and classrooms great. In determining staffing, we also relied upon our revised class policy, which provided building administrators with ranges that served as guidelines for determining class sizes in K-8, as well as retains course load guidelines for high school teachers. Our overall, our predicted decline in enrollment is 25 students across the district, with roughly 8 fewer students in the Pond Cove, 16 additional students in the middle school, and 33 fewer students at the high school. Because of shifts in student need, this budget also represents some difficult choices that were made, including the reduction of 4 positions. These cuts are the result of attrition due to retirement, reduction in special ed staffing due to decrease in student need, as well as straight out staff reduction. But we still have to turn on all the lights, heat every room, and run all the buses. On a positive note, we've also been thrifty with our energy costs. Between the new boiler at the middle school, increased use of LED bulbs, and Greg Marl's ability to negotiate great fuel rates, the district and the town have been able to keep those costs in check. CIP facilities and debt service take up only 10% of our budget, but often receive much attention. So let me review some of those highlights. CIP spending, or capital improvements projects, has increased while our debt service has decreased in accordance to our 10-year capital improvement plan, developed in conjunction with the town in 2013. Those spendings remain stable at roughly $2 million a year. To date, we have worked on $1.75 million in facilities projects, including roofing projects and HVAC work at each school, much needed electrical upgrade at the high school to literally keep the lights on, and the replacement of the middle school and Pond Cove boiler system, resulting in that cool new little outbuilding attached to the middle school for easy access and maintenance. Upcoming CIP projects for next year include a high school generator, because we are determined to keep the lights on at that school, as well as ventilators at the high school. At the middle school, our CIP plan calls for replacing the dishwasher, restroom stalls, and locker room upgrades. The plan also includes continued roofing upgrades throughout the district. Due to some recent events, we have also newly prioritized security upgrades district-wide. By law, school boards are charged with the care and maintenance of our public facilities, and these projects are a vital and necessary part of that work. All of these details and more can be found on the school board section of the district website. Click on school board, then budget information, and then the gray box called New Budget, Cape Elizabeth Schools 2016-2017 budget. The bottom line, I'm almost done, is that our proposed 2016-2017 school budget is $24,287,545 in expenditures, with an anticipated $2,624,954 in general state purpose aid. The result is a overall 3.9% tax increase, and on a median home valued at $314,000, that results in about $3,893 in taxes, or an increase of roughly $144 over last year. Looking forward, just to be clear, mark your calendars. The official date for presenting our budget to the town council is set for April 26th in downstairs conference room. That's a Tuesday night. Town council is set to vote on the acceptance of our budget and the total budget amount to send to voters on the evening of Tuesday, May 23rd. The citizens' vote for the town council adopted budget is set for Tuesday, June 14th, the primaries in the state of Maine. Discussion, questions, or concerns? Yes, John.
I just have two comments that I'm repeating that occurred during the workshop sessions, and I think they're important for when you look at our budget to understand what's going on. One of which is, if you look at debt service, the way we're reporting debt service now is somewhat different. It doesn't include all our debt service. It's only the statutory counted amount. And so there's other debt service that is now actually in other categories. If you want the detail of that, it's on the website. And the other one of which was repeating what Michael, I think, had said, which this is the largest drop percentage-wise in state aid that we've had in 10-some-odd years, larger than the drop we experienced when we had the biggest financial downturn in our lifetimes. And so I'm delighted that we're able to manage to keep the budget increase very modest by reducing undesignated funds to a minimum number, or say a low number. So,
thank you, John.
Thank you for all your work on the finance. But
it was a group effort.
Barbara?
Yeah, I would echo those. Thanks, Joe, and also mention that for anybody listening, I'm also pleased that we have enough in a contingency account so that as our new director arrives, as our new superintendent arrives, if there's any tweaking that needs to happen in staffing or programming or anything else, that there is a little leeway for that. And I go into that confidently. Last year we did that around some class size questions that worked out to great benefit of kids. And so I think it's a really appropriate measure for us to take to give new leadership a chance to take a look at things. Maybe it won't be needed, but it's there. We don't know all the answers sitting in April of what it'll be like as school opens in the fall. So I just want to say that added to my very strong confidence in this budget.
Thank you.
Suzanne?
Yeah. I want to make sure to thank Joe also and thank Catherine for transforming, I think, the budget report to something that makes a lot of sense visually, and I think will be very helpful in the future going forward and save a lot of time probably. I want to thank Meredith and everybody else on the board too. It's so hard facing a school budget when you know that you have to make hard decisions like we've had to make, and given the lack of the decline, the significant decline from state funding, I feel that we've done the best we can without increasing, you know, the tax burden on the town to a point that would be too painful. But I also just want to also point out that, or just have people realize that, thank goodness that we have the undesignated fund balance and the contingency fund in place, and just to be mindful that in the future, we should really do what we can to maintain that, and never, if possible, go below a certain point. Is it 2% that the auditors suggest? But this year we're lucky. We can use it. We can tap into it, and I hope that we can continue to keep it there when we need it in the future. If we do,
thank you.
Thank you.
Michael?
Yeah, just like I said, last year's budget, I think, was characterized as a windfall. I think the best way to characterize this year's budget is a significant shortfall. The best way to look at it, I know many in the community don't go to the budget website and just want to know, you know, what's the bullet point? How do I understand the budget? And the best way to explain it, I believe, is 82% of the tax increase that's proposed in this budget is due to the reduction in state revenue. So $944,000 property tax increase, $778,000 of that is from a reduction in state revenue. So even if spending is flat, you'd still have a significant shortfall of $800,000 in state revenue. A second, net spending increase of 1.97%. Also includes a very favorable health and premium increase of a 0% increase. So last year, health premiums actually declined. So the district's been able to maintain the excellence of the schools, but also has some favorable trends in healthcare cost. and for taxpayers, for many of them are very bottom line focused. So if you own a median home in Cape Elizabeth, over the last 2 years to sustain and invest in the schools, you've only had a $66 tax increase or 1.7% over 2 years. So while I'm happy to see our stringent, you know, cost management, I do think, you know, it does, it's just one metric for a budget is how much your spending increases or your tax increases. I also want us to remind ourselves how strong our schools are and that it is an investment. So I'm happy with where we ended up on the budget and just summarize 82% of the tax increase is directly attributable to the shortfall in state revenue.
So I just want to remind everybody that creating a budget for a school district, any school district, is difficult. It means thinking of how to allocate resources across the entire district, aligning spending with goals, and then negotiating competing interests. This is a lean budget, a maintenance budget for the most part. Efficiencies were found and capitalized upon. Expenditures were creatively funded as they were necessary to our strategic plan and capital improvement plan. Impact to student learning was our top focus at all times, followed closely by impact to taxpayers. I'd like to thank our superintendent, our business administrator, our building and department administrators for their work that began months and months ago. That work continued as the school board dug deeply into reviewing every department, every expenditure, every cut, every change. The budget that we vote on tonight has been painstakingly vetted, adjusted, and vetted again. There was robust discussion with extensive rounds of questions for each department head or administrator. The only changes this budget saw through this process really were reductions to taxpayer impact twice due to a slight increase in projected state subsidies and a lower than projected health insurance cost for next year. A modest increase to our contingency line, which we felt was really necessary, and that was also paid out of those health insurance cost savings. Then there was also a reallocation of resources within the facilities department to prioritize some security enhancement, but there was no net increase or decrease to the proposed budget. I support this budget wholeheartedly. It is aligned with our goals for facilities and student learning and capitalizes on efficiencies and shows sensitivity to the town that supports this district. All those in favor? Thank you.
Motion passed by May.
Yep.
So the other last comment I'd like to make about the budget is just has to do with communication to the board and the comments and other things we receive. We appreciate that and we take them all very seriously, and they do play a significant part in the deliberations that we undertake, and we thank you for them and look forward to more. Thank you.
Moving on to item 6B. May I have a motion, please?
I move we approve the recommended budgetary warrant article for submission to the town council.
Second. Discussion.
So in years past, we have requested warrant article language in regards to protecting the downside should state subsidy come in actually less than on which we have built our budget. We have neglected to be forthcoming in foresight and thinking about what would happen should state subsidy actually come in above the amount that has been shared with us to date. In the past, there has been 1 year in which we considered warrant article language in which asking for any additional state subsidy that did arise to be returned to the school. So this is an attempt to not forget that language here. The warrant language that was voted to be adopted is existent in your packet. I can read it aloud if you'd like.
I think it's helpful, especially, I think the second part, the hold harmless, people are used to, but the first part about...
Sure.
Someone else can read it if you're
having... No, I'm good. Okay, so ordered. Additional unanticipated state school subsidy that the town of Cape Elizabeth will authorize the school board to move all additional unanticipated state general purpose aid received for the fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2016 and ending June 30th, 2017 to the undesignated fund balance in order to support future educational needs. If the state general purpose aid subsidy is less than in the anticipated $2,624,954, the town council agrees to provide the school department protection from any shortfall, hereby authorizing the town treasurer to execute a journal entry to provide the net difference of any shortfall to be debited from the unallocated fund balance to be credited to the school department fund balance. So you'll notice that we've actually specifically actually asked that any additional state aid go straight to replenishing our undesignated fund balance should we face the same shortfall that we're experiencing this year. Barbara?
Yeah, I was just going to say that's a really important designation because in many communities, this language is allowing districts to bring potential, not that it's happening for sure, but potential additional subsidy into an operating budget and restoring programs or positions. And we're specifying for our voters and our counselors that this would go essentially into our savings account that we've had to draw from substantially over the past few years to keep tax rates down. So this is just refilling that in case there's further loss of revenue going forward, which is quite likely. So I think it's really important for our taxpayers to understand that it's just going into the savings account should any come in.
And understanding that for the school department to be able to use funds from that undesignated fund balance outside our regular budgeting, that the town council has to approve that. Okay. So there is that next level of
oversight.
So I would also add that this is one of the largest, if not the largest, drawdown in undesignated fund balance, similar to the size of the cuts that we'd received. And I would also say that, at least for me, the budget we are presenting forward is intrinsically linked to this warrant language, which gives me the comfort that we can keep our contingencies and undesignated funds at the levels they're at.
I just have a clarification. Maybe it's wordsmithing, but the title says additional unanticipated state school subsidy, but it also includes a scenario where there's not additional. So I don't know if we need to change that, but just to clarify, if state general purpose aid comes in greater than was included in the budget, we would request that that's assigned to the quote unassigned fund balance.
Correct.
And that's the same thing as undesignated fund balance.
Yeah, designated.
Whereas if we have a shortfall, it's to be debited from the unallocated fund balance and to be credited to the school department fund balance, which means you could use that for operating spending we've already included in the budget.
That's correct. So and that would be coming from town funds to be deposited in the school department's overall budget accounts to allow us to utilize funds for the operating budget that's already been approved.
And just got, we are not approving, the vote is to approve this order for consideration by the town council. One thing that, do we want to put the amount, or do you think it's implicit in the order that if additional anticipated state general purpose aid greater than $2,624,954, do you think it's self-evident?
So I'm going to defer that question to Catherine, who worked to get this
particular language, but I think that's pretty, this is fairly standard.
Okay.
It is very standard, and I don't feel that there's a need to add that additional monetary amount in there. I think it's fairly clear, but that is your final decision.
Nope, that's fine. I just want to make sure we...
While you're there, I think Michael's point that it does say additional unanticipated state school subsidy, if it just said changes to state school subsidy, that would probably be
both.
A more apt title for covering both scenarios.
I will make that note.
Do I have to read the whole thing over again since there was no more?
No. You do not.
I'm used to that at this point on this board, I got to tell you.
No one's making you read a lease purchase agreement.
Thank you. Good.
Okay. All those in favor? Thank you.
Thank you.
Moving on to item 6C. May I have a motion, please?
Sure. I move that we approve... before I make the motion, does this reference a proposal somewhere? In what?
It's the calendar included in your packet. Okay. That was discussed at the last meeting. It includes 6 early release days.
6? 7?
Is that right? Sorry.
7.
So this motion relates to one of the proposals. Okay. I move that we approve the Pond Cove School Student Early Release Day proposal for the 2016-17 academic year calendar.
Second. Discussion?
I'd like to say something, and it's taken me a while to really come with my own decision about this. I've been thinking a lot about, as we all have, professional development and how much time to give into work into the calendar, which then means taking away time from this children's day, children's school day. And I've struggled a lot with this, and I feel that in the long run, no one I think argues the value of professional development time, and I for one appreciate any extra time given and any extra time that the teachers and administrators use and provide to their building. But I feel like last year when the additional 5 days were put out for Pond Cove in particular, it was a, you know, even back then it was, it seemed to break the K-12 model that we're all working towards, and yet we also understood the value of trying out 5 early release days. So this year, looking for the next calendar, you know, we were very curious about the feedback from parents and whether or not the 5 days have been valuable to staff, and it sounds like the staff has definitely made the most of these 5 days. And I don't think any parent would ever argue that they wouldn't want their children's teacher to continue in any way possible with their professional development. But I do fear, though, with the younger students, that with so many extra days broken up, so many weeks, where it's not a full week, that it's much harder for the younger students to jump back into even the next day. I feel like in my own family and in other families that I've spoken to, when a half day is coming up, or when there's a early release day coming up in the week or starting off the week, sadly, I know my daughter doesn't think of it as a regular day, and it's not a regular day, it's a half day, but I think when we're looking at the calendar, we often look at the early release days, we count them as a regular day, but in fact, I think especially with the younger learners, my fear is that they
are looking at it as a day to not take seriously. I've been asked multiple times by my own daughter, can she have a sleepover on the days if there's a half day? I'm like, no, it's a school day. And then when they come home, like, you know, how was school? Like, oh, it was, yeah, you know, didn't really need to be there. And I think that's the reaction of a child, but it does strike a chord for me that I worry, and I feel it as a parent, that these half days are disruptive to their student engagement and the continuity of their school days. And when we were looking for creative options for trying to find a balance of professional days and also maybe being more mindful of keeping kids in school more consistently, I guess I was hoping for something maybe with a lot more creative thinking out of the box. And I think what I realized is that it's almost too late it was almost too late this time around to look at the calendar in the way that I was hoping, which was, you know, maybe next school year, the goal should be across all the buildings to look at the calendar in a new way, in a more creative way, where conferences aren't happening during the school day. That maybe professional development days and conference days can be, I don't know what the answer is, but arranged in a way that allows the kids to be in school more, and yet doesn't take away from extra professional development for teachers. So that's a whole ball of wax, I think, looking at the calendar in that way. But I think that, you know, we're a creative district. I think that we have the ability and the capacity to look at it in a brand new way. And I don't think it's anyway, I think we do have the capacity to look at our calendar for the next full year schedule in a way that's different from the way we have approached it and the way we're approaching it now. And then I guess ultimately the other thing that just is sort of like the pea under the mattress for me is, you know, given the shortfall in the budget this year, it feels like, you know, when Joe says, you know, it's still at the end of the day, we have to keep the lights on, we have to keep the buses running, somehow that rings true for me here, that at the end of the day, we still have to teach the kids. We do value professional development, but we still have to teach the kids. And so I've been struggling with the extension of 7 days. And I feel that, you know, we haven't heard much from parents, but I am a parent, and I've talked to other parents who do not feel like while they value professional development, they don't understand I shouldn't speak them. So anyway, I guess what I'm trying to say is that I think we need to keep this balance of professional development with also this impact of student learning. And I'm not suggesting that that is not at the forefront of teachers and administrators' minds. I know that it is, and of course professional development is all for that end reason. But I think that we have to really keep in mind a balance, and I think perhaps the 7 days that were proposed at our last business meeting in March, I was surprised to see 7 days. I thought the goal was going to be to somehow cut it back a little bit more, and I understand that with the 1:30 start, that was a reduction from the plan before that. But I still feel that 5 days is a lot, and it's already a lot to ask of parents and children. And I think if we can even keep our kids in a little bit longer on those 5 days, with the 1:30 release time, I think that might be the balance and the compromise that I'm most comfortable with.
Are you amending the motion?
So yes, I would like to suggest amending the motion of the PONCO calendar to reflect 5 early release days at a 1:30 dismissal time.
Do you have a second?
I second that. Okay. Can I comment?
Yeah, discussion on that.
I too have had children tell me that the half days don't feel like very much is done during those days. I also look at the calendar, and in September, there are only 2 full weeks. October, there's only 1 full week. November, there's 2. December, there's 2. January, there's 2. February, there's 2. March, there's 3. But April, there's 1. May, there's 3. And June is pretty full. And that just speaks volumes to me. To have so few full weeks is just disruptive. So I concur with Susanna that I would like to see and support professional development fully and completely, but there has to be a boundary to it to some degree, where we are having the kids in the classroom. So I second that emotion. Not emotion, motion. And emotion.
Discussion on the amendment. Is this discussion on the amendment?
Yes.
So I sit here as someone who went to public schools, and part of what they had to do while I was in public schools was to shut down about half the schools and earthquake-proof the ones that were shut down. So what that meant was, both in elementary school for 1 year and for 2 years in junior high school, I had half days essentially all year long. I don't think it really negatively impacted my education. The big difference was how the people treated those half days. All of those things were serious. And I think the challenge to us, as we look at this calendar and look at the half days, whether it's 5 or whether it's 7, is to have lesson plans and have expectations that this is serious work and we have things to get done. And that, you know, if it's coming across as if it's some sort of holiday or something different, we need to adjust to it, but it's up to us as a learning community to treat that seriously and get the work done. It doesn't have to negatively impact the kids in terms of time in the classroom. I experienced that for full 3 years of my own education. So I'm comfortable with the 7 days, the 130 days.
I think it's important to, you know, think critically, like we ask our teachers and students to do. So first of all, proposal one, it's not a half day proposal. Proposal one has dismissal at 1:30. So I think if you characterize it as a half day proposal, it's not a half day release proposal. It would end at 1:30. If 5 days for this year was too many, the proposal one, that's not a half day release, it's at 1:30. You're increasing instructional time versus this year's model of 5 days. So I think it's important not to get caught up in, well, gee, 7 days is more than 5 days. There's less instructional time. Proposal one would result in, by my calculation, I think it's 10.5 hours of instructional time that would be missed in the district. That's out of 1,137 hours and a half hours for the whole year. So I think you need to put it in perspective. 11 hours out of over 1,138 hours is around a 0.9% reduction in instructional time, but it's an improvement over the plan we have this year, which reduces instructional time by 15 hours, which is the 5 day that we're doing this year. The creative 7 day proposal actually increases instructional time versus what we're currently having in the district. Ultimately, I think it comes down to, we want teachers to do student-directed learning, which they already do. We want them to learn about differentiated instruction. We learned today there's this new teacher evaluation model. There's a lot of goals in the strategic plan. They need time to professional development in the plan. So you got to pay for it somewhere. And I think this threads the needle by limiting the impact on students, coming up with a creative option. It's not a half day option. If you want your child to stay at school for the continuity and ride the bus home like they always do, well, have them stay at school. You know, it's that same continuity. So I appreciate, the distraction of a half day, release schedule, and that's, I wouldn't support a half-day release proposal, and the great news is there's not one before us. Proposal one is not a half-day, so I can understand some of the angst, but I think it's a, does what the school board asks, think creatively, and also provides time for professional development. If we're not going to do it here, then the board would need to say, well, where are we going to do it?
So I would just like to characterize they're not half days, they're early release, regardless of the time that they get out. That's how they're characterized. For cultural expectations around the norm in a school, clearly those were extenuating circumstances, and that became the cultural norm within your district because it had to in order to operate. These early release days that have been requested through the Pond Cove, I completely understand the need for professional development, but they're additional days to the already early release days that are accommodated within the district. And last year, we struggled supporting five of those early release days throughout the district because of the recognition and the need of disruption to our student learning. The seven-day proposal, to me, kind of set me back. I was a little bit surprised where we had such resistance last year to the 5 days that there was a proposal this year for seven, and yet the need for professional development, I don't think, has actually increased over last year. I think it's remained the same. And disruption to a week is still a disruption to the week in our youngest learners, especially, who are of most need for a regular instruction week. So I support Susanna's motion for having a five early release days within our district and having those days be released at 1:30.
Perfect. I'll jump in. I hear where everyone's coming from. I really especially like your suggestion that next year we start out earlier and really look at the full school calendar and so forth, but I appreciated coming back with the hour and a half. I remember thinking aloud about that at one point. That seemed a lot less disruptive to me, and I appreciated their logistical support of kids staying at school, which takes the onus off struggling working families. I totally get that too. And if I put my old teacher hat on, really working and digging in at work and being able to get to it in a regular way makes it a lot more efficient and effective than having big gaps of time in between. I can remember being very frustrated both as a principal and a teacher about that. And so I too look forward to more creative, but because of the change to 1:30 and to Michael's point of a very little loss of instruction time, really the 2 days differences we're talking, you know, 90 minutes times two. So I go back to reading about the state-selected elementary school principal of the year this year, and in the nugget that was released about that person, I can't remember their name or where they're from, but one of their things they were being rewarded for was they had found a way to give their teachers time to learn together and to work on professional learning together. It's a very huge challenge in an elementary school. And if we pushed it too hard, the inequities with their middle and high school counterparts are enormous. We will never exactly match, no matter how much we stand on our head, what middle and high school teachers get. So to me, that flips it toward, let's do what we can. They came back with an hour and a half. It's going to be a regular access for them, and I support it.
Thank you. I struggle with this, and it's my hope, it's my goal, it's my plan that we will look at calendar in a broader context, because we've all been talking about this five versus seven, but it is not five versus seven. There are other early release K-12 days in here, so we're really talking about, like, you know, 8 versus 10 is what we're really talking about. We're not talking, and while this proposal is about Pond Cove, my concern is about those, you know, conferences that are during the day that are part of those interrupted weeks that Heather brought up. The early release days that aren't just Pond Cove, but that are K-12.
we really, I really want us to look at that, that important time that students are in the classroom with their teachers. On this, I mean, not even on the other hand, on the same hand, I believe that that time that teachers spend honing their craft and learning and working, make that time that they are in the school classroom with their students better. And so it's incredibly important. But we need to, I think we do need to have that bigger look at, we have, I mean, it's been brought up many times by many different people. We have a lot of interrupted weeks. And whether they're getting out at 1:30 or 12, it kind of doesn't, it's interrupted weeks. And it really does kind of put a hiccup in the momentum of learning. So I would love for us to make that something that we look at next year. And I call for any more discussion, and then we're going to move on and have a vote.
You have to vote on the amendment first.
Yeah, we're voting on the amendment. The amended vote motion, rather, is what we're voting on.
Vote to amend.
Oh, do we have to vote to amend?
So we are voting on this amendment. The amendment was proposed, so we're going to take a vote now.
Okay, we don't have to vote to put,
no.
Right.
If you approve the amendment, then it moves forward, and if not, then it does not.
So we are voting on the amended motion at this time.
Which all is those, just to be clear, for 5 days at 1:30.
Okay. All those in favor? All those opposed? Okay.
So now we have to vote on the amended motion.
No, the amendment. The amended motion passed.
So we are moving on to item 6D.
Can I just wait one clarification about that? So you've approved a calendar with 5 early release days, as I understand it, based on the amendment to that motion. So at the moment, there are 7 on the draft calendar, so we will need to adjust that before we make that public. So unless the board has a strong interest in making that decision, we will make that decision at the administrative level.
May I just suggest, in looking at the calendar, there's 2 of those proposed early release days happen in months that precede school vacation. And my suspicion is keeping kids engaged prior to school vacation is challenging without those early release days. Just a suggestion.
Item 6D. May I have a motion, please?
I move that we approve the following policies and procedures for second reading and adoption.
A second.
DF fundraising, DFR fundraising procedure, DFF student activity funds, JJIBC athletic booster organizations, and KJA relations with booster organizations, and remove and delete DFAB athletic booster organizations, which has been recoded as JJIBC.
Okay. Let me report on the policy committee's review after our first reading on these. And for those listening, the D series of policies has to do with fiscal management. So there were no changes made to the fundraising as you saw it last time. On DFR, fundraising administrative procedure, there's one deletion of 2 sentences I want to bring your attention to in the opening paragraph. This is fundraising administrative procedure, DFR, for those listening. It starts off with, the Cape Elizabeth School Board recognizes that most fundraising affiliated with the school unit falls within the categories of student slash school-based fundraising or school-affiliated fundraising, period. And we're striking, these are guidelines that apply to all fundraising efforts that benefits the schools. This procedure excludes the Cape Elizabeth Education Foundation. And I'll speak to that later when we get into news. But that language is struck, and that's the only change to what you were had in front of you last time on DFR. On, let's see, get to it. The JJIBC was, student activity funds, DFF. There was just one change made to that and that was the, this is the idea of as classes graduate, that after a year, they need to clean up their remaining class funds after they've graduated, where now we're saying exactly where it will go. Instead of being transferred to the general fund, it will be transferred to the principal's account or designated student activity account, so that it goes to continue to work on things directly impacting kids and their activities. So unclaimed money would go there. A class can certainly pull it out and keep it for reunions and so forth, but that would allow, that directs it better to where that would land. That's the only change in DFF. And then, as Joanna mentioned in her motion, DFAB, Athletic Policy, Athletic Booster Organizations, is just being moved to J, which is the Community Relations section of policy. Under KJA, Relations with Booster Groups, that also remained unchanged. It did give our athletic administrator the opportunity to meet with several of booster representatives. There were a few questions for us, but they were clarified in a close read of this policy, where they are not being required to set up a 401(c) as a non-exempt group. That has some cost involved, but just that they have keep their bank, financial, and tax status separate from the school. And Catherine is going to be working on reporting templates for them, so there's continuity in how payables and so forth are reported to us and the status of their current accounts. So this is really reflecting how we do business now. There's no major change to it, it's just really clarifying things. And then you'll see the DFAB that's completely eliminated as the recode. So that's the ones we're voting on this evening.
I just need a quick education on the tax status question.
Yes.
So if we're removing the reference to 503B because of financial implications having to set one up, are we then condoning for-profit organizations to do fundraising on our behalf?
No, what it simply means that some groups are so large they prefer acting independently and then can make purchases that are tax exempt, whereas most of the boost organizations purchase through the school, and that way our tax exempt status goes along with their purchases. So if they run them through the school, we're good.
Okay, thank
you. If they purchase on their own, they need their own tax exempt status, or they'd have to pay sales tax.
But didn't you strike the tax exempt portion of
no.
that?
No. What it's saying is they don't have to have their own tax exempt status.
Okay.
But purchasing that comes through the schools and then reimbursed by that organization can receive the same tax exempt umbrella.
Thank you.
Okay. Some just prefer.
I'm glad I asked. I got a little.
Well, some just prefer to work completely independently, and then that allows them to do that.
So we're requiring a separate tax ID, but not any particular status.
Correct. That's what I'm understanding.
Right. They don't have to go all the way to file for 401(c).
Yep. Any, as long as they're separate.
Yep.
Any tax status will do, whether it's a for-profit or non-profit.
That's the understanding?
Yeah.
Okay. All those in favor? Oh, sorry, Michael, I didn't.
DFR, maybe you admit we struck out these guidelines or to apply to all fundraising efforts that benefit the schools. This procedure excludes the Cape Elizabeth Education Foundation.
Do you want me to speak to that for a minute?
Well, my question is, if that's not in there, then if someone read this policy and said, well, would
so we only govern the school,
right.
And CEF is not part of the school. They are a separate tax-exempt organization. And so to have guidelines that say, well, this applies to all the school organizations, that's sort of covered under the fact that it's already a school-based policy. And to specifically call out CEF feels inconsistent with other pieces. They are a separate organization, and we have another policy that we are currently working on as a committee that specifically addresses our relationship with the Cape Elizabeth Education Foundation, but we don't govern how they choose to raise funds. We don't have any say in that piece.
Right. We're not asking to pre-approve their fundraising activities and so forth.
Right. I just want to clarify, because someone would assume by crossing it out,
right.
You're saying, well, if we had language in there that excluded them. If you remove that language,
right,
it means they're included, but right, just to make sure people understand.
We were hoping to bring with you, first reading tonight of the updated relations with the Cape Elizabeth Education Foundation policy, but we need a little more time to prepare it. But that is coming, and that will answer that question. Good question, though. I'm glad you raised it.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Do we want to cross-reference the CEF policy in order to help clarify that there's not...
Well, there isn't one yet, is the problem.
Okay.
That reads in a way that will reflect what we're looking at. But yes, ultimately, we'd cross-reference that to this for fundraising of them. That would make sense. So if someone wanted to look ahead to KCE or whatever,
we'll
it is...
We'll just bring this back right, when that's
right,
ready.
Right.
Okay, that makes sense.
And I think to your point, Michael, which might be helpful, is the part where it says student school-based fundraising or school-affiliated fundraising. And that's what our policies are allowed to govern. And CEF is not student or school-based.
Right. To Meredith's point, that we don't really have business... with them, but we want to define our relationship with them because obviously they work to partner with us carefully. So
that makes sense. Good work.
Thanks.
And I don't want to jump the gun again. Does anybody have any further discussion? All those in favor? Thank you.
Thank you.
Item 6E does not need a motion.
Right. So the first reading policies that are in front of you are pretty straightforward. JJJ, and I promise you we're not diving back into high school co-curricular and extracurricular activities and eligibility and code of conduct. You spent a lot of time on that already. But Jeff Shedd, our high school principal, came to us with one small tweak he asked that we consider in a first reading this evening. You'll find it scratched out in paragraph 2B under academic eligibility. This gets fairly complicated for our administrators to monitor, and the point is, the bottom line is, we're trying to get our student athletes and our co-curricular participants to understand they need to be in good standing with their grades. They need to put time into their grades and into their sports or band or robotics or whatever else is going on. So there is a provision in here around the failure of a course and how they'll be on probation and so forth. And what I really like about it is the recovery plan and so forth. It's not just punitive, it's meant to be a safety net under our kids. The part he's asking us to delete says, any course failure in the quarter following probation will result in immediate ineligibility. He said that's become extremely hard to monitor and it's really an unnecessary add to this policy. So first reading consideration is that we strike that. And we supported that at the policy committee.
I just have to say, having lived through being chair when we reviewed this, I'm shocked that that even made it through, because that was not the spirit of the committee at the time. So thank you for catching that.
And then KCD is a new policy that we're considering that the Maine School Management Association is suggesting all schools adopt, called public gifts, donations to the schools. For those of you that are listening this evening, it has to do with an individual who may step up and, in graciousness, offer either property or a money gift to the schools. And this is directing that the superintendent can accept on behalf of the school unit and the school board anything in amount of property or request or money up to a commercial value of $5,000 or less. And that the board will be informed of these gifts and direct the superintendent to thank donors in writing on behalf of the board. What we missed in the first reading, which I will add as a sentence, is the superintendent will bring before the board gifts of $5,000 or more for approval and public acknowledgement. Mm-hmm. So that we'd like a chance to understand when such large gifts are coming in, what the purpose is, the impact, and the so forth, but also for purposes of public acknowledgement about something that grand. So we'll like clean that language up for the second read and get that to you in a timely way. As in the grand piano. That's right. That was good.
Thank you. You're all night.
Any questions on that one or suggestions? And next time we will bring you the first read, right, Catherine, about our relations with the Cape Elizabeth Education Foundation.
I'd like to thank Barbara and the policy committee for this ongoing work. I attended the last policy committee meeting. There was greater than usual attendance, which was really nice, and excellent discussion. And so I thank you for that work.
Absolutely, and
it's the backbone of our work.
And we had representatives from CIF join us for a dialogue, and it was really helpful.
It was. Very helpful. But thank you. Thank you for getting up early and doing that work. So moving on to item 6F. May I have a motion, please?
Sure. I move that we approve the following athletic staff nominations at the middle school: Maureen Curran for softball, grade 8, Erin Filio for baseball, grade 7, Nicole Carrera-Cerois for track in 8th, Per Norius in track 7th grade, Max Pulsifer for lacrosse boys, grade 8, Sarah Jordan for lacrosse girls, grade 7, and then the high school, Mike Foley for lacrosse girls, JV assistant, and Seth Dobieski for baseball, JV assistant, first team.
Second.
Discussion?
I'd just like to thank all of these folks for stepping up, needed and necessary.
Yes, I agree, and it's also, I love to see how many are on staff here too and know the kids so well, or are returning coaches and already know so many members of the team, so thank you.
It's a nice connection. Mm-hmm. All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6G. May I have a motion, please?
I move we approve the Cape Elizabeth's Teacher and Administrator Performance Evaluation and Professional Growth, or PEBG, plans as recommended by the Evaluation Steering Committee.
Second.
Discussion?
What would we be approving? It's a pilot program, there's a date, and there's some changes that are going to be made. So I'm not quite sure what I'm being asked to approve.
You're being asked to approve the plans as they exist today, because that approval is required under law for submission to the DOE for their approval as well, and that allows us to move forward with the pilot. And again, should we make changes to the plan moving forward, those changes would be brought back to the board for approval and resubmitted to the Department of Education for approval to make sure that the plan remains in accordance with state law.
So if we approve this, this is for what's in place today, but we're not approving or limiting the opportunity to make some of the changes that were discussed. This is just for the plan that's in place today that we have to approve to submit to the DOE.
I think I heard Marguerite say that if they make substantive changes, it'll have to come back to us anyway, so.
Right. Further discussion? All those in favor? Thank you.
A lot of work.
Yes, a lot of work. Item 6H, may I have a motion, please?
I move that we adopt the school board goals for 2016-2017 as outlined in our packet.
I second. So I would just like to briefly just read those goals. We met as a full board back in January for our retreat. And a lot of that time was spent really looking toward our superintendent search. A little bit of time at the beginning, we were able to do some team building and talk about goals. And although we have had a lot of work before us that has been both urgent and important, this is also important because effective boards are goal-setting boards. So it was important for us to circle back to this. And these aren't goals that are forever, because as we have an incoming superintendent, we will meet with that superintendent and re-examine and think about new goals. Our goals are, number one, hire a superintendent and create transition plan and first year goals. Number two, adopt a budget that supports our strategic plan goals and is sensitive to our community. Number three, continue to review and update policies. which does include looking at our safety and emergency management policy. Number four is prioritize communication, especially regarding budget and superintendent search process. Further discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Moving on to item seven, committee reports. We've heard a pretty thorough reporting from policy.
But I think I've wrapped up finance.
Finance seems to be well represented as well. Any other committee reports at this time? Okay. And item eight, school board agenda requests.
So this may be anticipating one you already have in mind, but I think we should add some meeting soon, a discussion of calendar, both in terms of finding professional development time, but I also would say, as we're opening up the calendar, we ought to look at also start times in light of what the deferred and select board just recently did in terms of their high school morning start times and the evidence that supports later start times. If we're opening up the calendar, this is a good opportunity to revisit that. Mm-hmm.
And that may be to begin with more suitable for a workshop and then move into a business meeting.
However,
okay. Thank you. And as always, agenda requests don't have to come through this forum. Any agenda requests can be sent to the superintendent or myself and through email. Check the website, the department website, if you're not familiar with our email addresses. Item nine, announcements of upcoming meetings. And we've got.
You want to go?
Get a list.
I was going to say, there's a list, shall we?
Do you want me to review the?
Well, I'll say April 26th, that's the most urgent upcoming meeting, is the budget presentation to the town council. And then policy is May 2nd at 7:30 a.m. and May 4th is a Spurwink School Committee meeting.
Covered. Great. Everybody's favorite, item 10.
I move we adjourn.
Second. All those in favor? Thank you.
Thank you.
I would like it noted it is 9:10.